This is Brent of the Brookbush Institute, and in this video we're going to go over a joint-based manual therapy technique. If you're watching this video, I'm assuming you're watching it for educational purposes and that you're a licensed professional with joint-based techniques within your scope. That means osteopaths, chiropractors, physical therapists, you're probably all in the clear. Physical therapy assistants, athletic trainers, massage therapists, you need to check with your governing body in your state or region to see whether this is within your scope of practice. Personal trainers, this is definitely not within your scope of practice. Of course, all professions could use this video for purely educational purposes to help with learning biomechanics, anatomy, and of course, palpation. In this video, we're gonna do our superior to inferior or cranial to caudal clavicle on sternum mobilization. So this is our caudal sternoclavicular mobilization. I'm gonna have my friend Melissa come out and help me demonstrate. Now, this is an interesting technique that I want you guys to keep in your back pocket. I find it very, very helpful for those stubborn, stiff shoulders where you can't quite figure out how to get that last 5 degrees of shoulder flexion or 5 degrees of shoulder external rotation. And I know some of you guys are thinking, well, wait a second, how does the sternoclavicular joint contribute to shoulder range of motion? And this gets a little deep into biomechanics, but we do have some research to suggest that those with shoulder impingement or shoulder dysfunction do not get enough elevation and posterior rotation of the clavicle during elevation of the arm. So if we're not getting enough motion of the clavicle, we might want to start thinking towards, well, could we have stiffness in the SC and AC joint? Now in this video, we're going to focus on an SC joint mobilization. So why would I go superior to inferior? Well, if I'm thinking about trying to get more elevation of the clavicle, based on the way the clavicle is shaped being a saddle joint, we can presume that it follows concave on convex rules in the frontal plane, right? So this joint wants to, as the clavicle elevates, roll superiorly, which means we also need to glide inferiorly. Hence, why we come back to this superior to inferior glide that I want you guys to keep in the back of your brain to try to help elevation of the clavicle, which just may help you get those extra few degrees with that stubborn, stiff shoulder. So from here, we kind of need to know, how do we place our hands? How are we going to make this technique work? And that all starts with your knowledge of anatomy and being able to palpate. And I would start with just palpate the clavicle. Try to outline the clavicle if you've never done that before. I mean, we all know where our collarbones are, that's fine. But start visualizing the shape of the clavicle and try to find the rounded ends of the clavicle. One rounded end, the distal end, would be the AC joint, but that proximal end is right where the sternoclavicular joint is. And if you keep exploring the border of that rounded proximal end, you can actually feel like a depression, like a line between the flat sternum, or in this case actually the manubrium, which is the top of the sternum, and the rounded edge of the clavicle. And what I'm going to have you guys do is, once you find that, without jabbing somebody in the neck, which I know I just jabbed Melissa in the neck there, but without jabbing her in the neck, I want you guys just to take two fingers and put them right over the joint line. We're gonna use these as our feelers of joint glide. Once again, it's one of those things where I just don't see taught often enough in joint mobilizations, is if you have a free hand, if you have the opportunity to use your fingertips to feel a joint line, it's always a good idea to do so. It's gonna help you determine when your first motion happened at the joint, and of course when the end of arthrokinematic motion or the end of glide happened as well. Now the way I'm gonna mobilize this joint is a little different than this technique, which I've seen traditionally in texts and in some videos. This is pokey. Like, you guys could just see Melissa's face kinda, and I think some clinicians are okay with a little pokiness sometimes if they have to, and not that I want to say that there's a problem with that, but there is an alternative way to do this technique where you just don't need to be poking at somebody's bony sternoclavicular joint. Use these two fingers to feel the joint line, and then just use your thenar eminence close to the joint line on the clavicle. All right, so if I do this,
You guys can see now, notice I have my fingers pointed up here, right? Like, we don't want roaming fingers over somebody's chest. No need to get yourself into trouble. But if I just put my thenar eminence nice and close to the joint line and I press in an inferior direction, I can immediately feel the clavicle move against my fingertips. No need to do this. Nice broad surface area, not pokey, and providing I don't let my hand slide down over the top of Melissa's neck like I'm gonna choke her, like we definitely don't want anything like that. And if I just kind of keep right on top of the clavicle and I push that way, how does that feel?
Good.
A lot better than this, right?
Yes.
Okay, yeah. Pokey, not pokey. All right. A couple precautions before we get started with our protocol here, guys. Watch their sternocleidomastoid. Keep in mind that your sternocleidomastoid like goes right over the top of your sternoclavicular joint. So if somebody starts tensing up and starts really guarding on you, you're not gonna get a good mobilization. It's also gonna make them feel a lot more uncomfortable because it's going to put a lot more tense muscle in your way, which we don't want anything bearing down on the neck. So fingertips here, thenar eminence here. I'm watching to make sure that her sternocleidomastoid aren't getting geared up. And then I'm just gonna go, okay, where's my first resistance barrier? And it's right there. And then where's the end? Is right there. I'm gonna back off to 50%. And then I can either do my grade threes by coming all the way back to the first resistance barrier and doing like a larger amplitude mobilization here. Or I could do my grade four, going all the way to our through kinematic end range, back off to 50% and stay right there at 50%, being a little bit more intense than our grade threes. Now, one thing I do want you guys to notice is how straight this arm is. Like, I'm basically locked out here and I'm using my core muscles to push. So don't think because you're seated, you're gonna get away with like muscling this technique. You don't wanna turn this into like a chest press. Like, this is not a good thing. Notice how like I'm just like rocking her whole body anyway. What I really wanna do is have my arms pretty much straight out, be straight on to the table with my feet, and then like I'm just using the weight of my trunk to push into Melissa's clavicle. Stay tuned for your close-up recap. To give you guys a different view of our superior to inferior sternoclavicular mobilization, the first thing we're gonna do is palpate the clavicle, right? So hopefully you guys can kind of see how I'm outlining the clavicular bone. And I actually wanna follow the clavicular bone medially until I fall off the clavicular bone. I can feel this nice round bump here, and it approximates the rather flat manubrium, which is the top of my sternum. So you guys can see here, my fingers are on this flat sternum, and then if you watch me kind of go like this, medial to lateral, you guys can see my fingers kind of bump up over the rounded edge of the clavicle. Now, what I want to do is actually use my other hand to palpate the joint line. So I'm gonna palpate my joint line, and that's gonna help me determine when my arthrokinematic motion starts with this mobilization, when I've hit end range arthrokinematic motion. And I mentioned before, I'm just gonna use my thenar eminence here close to the joint without being on top of Melissa's throat and without having to be on top of my fingers, because that's not gonna be very comfortable for me. So right here is probably good, and I can feel as soon as I push down, I can actually feel with these fingers that joint start to move. So there's my first resistance barrier, just that easy. And then I can feel the end of arthrokinematic motion, and then back off to 50%, and I can do either my grade threes by starting at first resistance barrier and going to 50% in a larger amplitude, or I can stay at 50% in small amplitude and do my grade fours. Notice this is fairly comfortable for both Melissa and myself, since I have my arms straight and I'm just using my torso, my core muscles essentially, to create the oscillatory motion. I'm not using my hand strength, I'm not using my arm strength. It's really just the weight of my torso leaning forward and a little core strength to create that oscillatory motion. Once I finish 1 to 2 oscillations per second and start to feel a decrease in arthrokinematic stiffness, I'll then go ahead and reassess.
So there you have it. Assess, address, reassess. Make sure that every time you choose a joint-based manual therapy technique, it is based on an assessment and that you return to that assessment after you finish the intervention to see if it was effective for the individual, the patient or client that you have in front of you. Ensure that you continue to learn your anatomy, because your anatomy is going to help you with your hand placement, with understanding what a joint can do, with understanding what you may gain from this particular technique. And of course, practice. You have to practice these techniques, hopefully not for the first time on a patient or client who just walked in the door. If you can, find a more senior instructor or a mentor to give you some really good hands-on instruction. Use your peers for some good feedback. And of course, always look for live education to help with your manual therapy techniques. I know these videos make education very convenient, but there is no substitute for learning manual therapy in a live setting. I look forward to talking to you guys again soon.